You can't go wrong with just a fade in, a fade out.
Quality fade.
And you know, like, you know.
My name is Drew. I play drums in this band. Today was the first day of tracking for the new record, Who Can Know It.
Took a long time to set the drums up and everything and get them just right. So day one was a lot of sitting around.
Took a very long time. We sat in the lobby for a vast majority of it. Drew hit some drums, tuned them occasionally, and every time we got close, something else would go wrong. We had to switch the bass drum, we had to switch the snare, our channels were messed up, stuff we don't understand.
I've been involved with a few recording processes or processes in the past, but never something on this level.
This whole thing has been really surreal, really strange, because we did the last record with just four people mainly, so the four piece wasn't that strange, but at some point Patrick said, it just felt so good to look around on that stage and see this band and hear this song and then turn around and see Sylvia and Rich back there behind the console.
I'm not gonna lie, I was a little bit nervous to be working with, such people as Sylvia and Rich. We did drum tracking for the first song on the record called Man with a Hammer.
Drew did two drum takes and got it. There is nothing like the sound of drums on Stage A, Studio A. It's just the best drum sounds there ever is. We first really realized it when the Age of Reptiles and Naked Lunch, that opening drums come in. That's just as good as drums can sound, and we'll get better than that. And we're back there again. That's very encouraging for all of us.
And then we did a very tiring workout about 30 minutes ago, and I'm really tired.
Today is day one of Insanity. Oh, hey, we've done On Bread that we're not going to drop out for the first month. The whole time we're in the studio. My main concern is with Garrett.
I ain't quitting no matter what.
Insanity, this DVD workout program that we've been excited about for a while. Today was day one, and it was insane. We made it through it. Me and Josh and Drew made it through it, like, heaving and sweating, and had to stop a lot. Garrett had to stop and go throw up.
I'm not gonna lie.
I'm terrified right now. I'm
scared.
I've heard a lot of scary stuff about this workout we're about to do.
Insanity? Yeah. Show me what we're gonna look like. That lady.
Even though I know it can be, I just can't imagine it. So I'm kind of excited to see how much this hurts.
About 10 minutes, it won't take much.
We got up real early and prayed together today. Everyone was sitting at a table, eating cereal, reading their Bibles together, and we prayed before we left this room that we're staying in and just basically begged the Holy Spirit to come join us here and just flow in every single thing that we're doing. And I was praying for that during the day as well. And it's a weird thing. When it happens, you really know it. But then sometimes it happens and you don't know it until afterwards.
I had a tuna fish sandwich, which I'm happy about because I used to not like tuna fish, but I like it now with mustard and relish and all that is.
G-Man quit after like 2 minutes.
Yeah, he didn't last very long.
Said he had to go throw up.
And then he didn't. He told me he didn't throw up.
Said he had to throw up. Went to the bathroom for like, while we're still working out, went to the bathroom for 10 minutes.
came back and just chilled the entire other 20 minutes. And then we found out later he didn't even throw up.
You know, looking at Sylvia and Rich's resumes of the artists they've worked with in the past, like Chili Peppers and Tool, I was really nervous, you know. I was like, dang, I hope I don't get in there and can't play to the click for some reason. And
what we first started on was drums. We set up in Studio A, which is a very large theater.
He really played well. All this work you've been putting together and working on, and it's coming together, and like this is the first part of the process.
It was really fun to hear great drumming sounds.
We're supposed to, in a few minutes, start working on more drum stuff and bass stuff today. So I'm getting my stuff together. Hey, look at my big old amp here. It looks nice though, huh? Vintage. It's hipster. This is my go-to guy whenever we're here. I used it for the fear of God. And it was actually the first time we used it here because it was broke the other two times. But it's the same thing as the basic classic amp, but it's louder. It sounds nice. And here's my tuner. All this stuff looks nice, but I'm just using the tuner. I actually used this on the first two albums, Nihilism and Reptiles. Anorexia, we didn't use anything. It was not fun.
We started playing the first song on the album, A Man With a Hammer. He was doing it so well that he did it in basically one take, and we did an extra one to have it, and it was like, yeah, that's good.
This is day two of tracking, song two of tracking for drums and most likely bass. We did A Man With a Hammer yesterday. I'm gonna start with I Never Liked Anyone today. This is my Telecaster. I threw it at RevGen this summer. Got that nice little chip.
So you roll the dice, say I'm white and I go first, whatever. So that's a 6 and a 1. So I can move a piece either 7 or, I mean, you have to be able to stop wherever. So that's 6 and then 1. You could do that, right? Right?
Yeah.
So then this guy rolls, right? So he's going this way.
With the way we record track drums, the entire band is on stage and we all play together live. We have the extra tracks in our headphones, the extra synthesizers and, you know, flutes and triangles and stuff. And we're playing guitars and Drew's playing drums and everyone's hearing everything in their headphones and we're singing and everything. And that way Drew has the entire band experience while all that we're recording is the drum set. So that you forgot who you were. Really,
the sentinels left charge over. Sorry.
What is it?
My bad. That was us. We just we missed it. We got it now.
You know, it just clicked, it felt really good. And the entire time, you know, Sylvia and Rich were both really encouraging and had, you know, nothing but kind words to say. Something about that room in there is just really comfortable and it just felt really good sitting behind that kit and playing.
That process was just real exciting and real fun, that it went like this every day. We'd do a couple of takes of songs on drums and that was it. We'd move on. Good job, dude.
Sides.
somehow got off. I don't know what happened, but we'll fix it.
Those tracks got really low.
We did 8, right?
What are tracks in?
Keys.
We're about to do insanity again. I really hate this workout. I've been bummed out for like the last 2 hours because I knew it was coming. But bottom line is, I know I'm going to do better than Garrett. So really, I think I did better on today's because I hadn't worked out in a while before yesterday. So, you know, it wasn't just like a cold run today. I was kind of expecting it to be really, really bad, and it was, but at least I was ready for it.
Garrett, how'd your 10 minutes go?
It was real good, as you can tell.
I got really dizzy in the warm-up, man.
So, this is my confession. That was your song?
Yes, I know the Usher song.
But for the most part, drums are done. Bananas make you have bad dreams.
It was a good day. Spent a lot of time doing drums. We pretty much finished all the drums. I guess I should say Drew pretty much finished all the drums. Played them like a champ, Drew.
Thanks. I'm a champ because of Jesus.
And then for some unknown reason, we watched Cougar Town. Because we heard Jennifer Aniston was going to be on it. And we're like, oh, this might be kind of cool. It's Rachel and Monica.
Drew's discussing me alone. How is this man going to, like, literally, insanity is tough, man. Like, all of us are, you know, dripping sweat. Garrett's sweating just watching us. And it's just tough, like, soaking wet. Very hard. And this man just stops, puts on some clothes, eats dinner, and goes to bed. Sickening. Did you even brush your teeth?
Yes, I did.
Okay, he brushed his teeth.
We have a very excellent bass sound going on in A right now with the SVT. So we're going to hang around in Studio A to record some bass.
It's the end of day.
We didn't do nothing.
It was all drum edits, so that doesn't require us at all.
A couple days ago, Rich taught me and Patrick how to play backgammon. And
we played.
Today we played our first game, and it was a lot of fun, even though we started out playing. Setting up the pieces wrong, but we're gonna play tomorrow.
Is that the right one right there?
Yeah.
So what was it?
I plugged it into the wrong.
After drums, we started on bass, which we also did in Studio A.
Played my bass parts in the auditorium where we did Drew's stuff. It was really quick because I'm really good, because it was just really quick.
Change. Let's try it again.
Josh and Garrett and me, we all played bass on it.
Patrick, our bass player, plays most of the songs, but we tried switching it up a little bit on this record, and Josh and myself played bass on a couple.
It's kind of funny when you think about it. We thought it would be interesting to like split musical duties throughout the band, and in doing so, we didn't think to ourselves, "Hey, I'm much more used to playing this instrument than you are," or in some cases, much better at it. And we spread out the responsibilities to where it's just very obvious, like. Garrett was playing bass, and Rich started being like, "What are you doing? Do it this way, do it this way." And Garrett said, "I'm not a bass player." And Rich goes, "What the heck do you have the bass guitar for?"
Are you close to having rhythm guitars for playing underneath that?
Trying to set up a tuner. Some reason it's giving us a little bit of trouble.
So
I don't think they have it going on.
Tuner problems.
Do we have like a little short jumper?
Yeah,
a shorty.
What'd you do?
We moved over from Studio A, which is the theater, down the road a bit to Studio C. Or is it D? D, right, Studio D. It changes a lot, I apologize. Studio D is a house that belonged to Sylvia's mother, Miss Ida. And they renovated into a studio, and then Sylvia's mom actually moved back into the house. So now Miss Ida lives there in the house, and in her garage type area has been renovated into a very nice studio setting. And this was the first time in Showbread's 4 visits to the Radio Star that we recorded in Studio D.
And it's really nice. It's got a big, you know, elk on the wall.
At times it was pretty boring. I'm not gonna lie. So I had probably about 3 weeks of just sitting around watching the other guys track guitars and do keyboards and sing. And you know, even though it's something that I wasn't, you know, playing, I still, you know, wanted to be really involved with the process.
Get some protein in before Insanity every day, so I don't get sick. Black eyed peas, I got some protein.
But I don't like, for a quick lunch, having to open the can, put them on the stove in the microwave, heat up a bowl, wash a bowl. So I've just taken to eating them out of the can.
Lukewarm.
That's how Rorschach did it. So.
Yeah, and Rorschach did it this way, so. Next thing you know, I'll be making that human bean chest.
You'll be
young.
The walls are painted blue. And the vaulted ceiling.
It's got a vaulted ceiling. Very nice.
I did. I pulled
a big old chair.
Some couches.
Wow.
That's probably the most, inspiring or artistic part of the whole process, because with guitars and keyboards and bass, the parts are, you know, you got it mapped up in your mind, but as you're playing it, sometimes you hear other parts that would work better, and you got Rich helping us, like, why don't you play this there? And, you know, like everybody else is like, hey, Garrett, try this differently, or, you know, Josh, try that differently, and let's hook up some more pedals, let's sling the guitar around, Drew stand up against the closet and just like wave it around and get some feedback.
Garrett, myself, and Patrick were all playing guitar on this album, and all the parts are so much more complicated than on another Showbread record, and I don't mean like they were crazy leads, but they were just, none of the parts on the songs are just simple chording type things. If you know anything about guitar, you just, you know, you have your A, B, whatever. But on these songs, all of them are really strange single note or single string progressions.
Am I wrong, Drew?
I think that's right.
Okay, that sounds right.
And then what I'm playing is something completely different. And then what Patrick's playing is something completely different. So you can't base the melody off of any single part. It has, you know, like, you have to hear all three of them together with all the keyboards, and then you kind of hear what the melody is supposed to be like. So this created intense discrepancies in Rich's brain.
To keep descending, but it's the other guitar that continues to descend, so they sort of hand off to each other.
Scrambled egg, man.
Showbread goes maiden.
One guitar is doing a scale, the second guitar is completely different, and the bass is completely different, and the keyboards are completely different. So he'd be like, I hear a funny note in this section.
He would take out this little toy piano that he kept under his desk. And when that piano came out, we all knew that he was going to be working on this for a good half hour or an hour.
And we'd be like, well, where? He'd say, I think it's right around here. Which thing is doing it? I have no idea.
Okay, one more time then, right?
Yeah.
A lot of fun and a lot of work, that's for dang sure. A lot more work than if we would have played power chords like the punk records that we used to do.
This thing's kind of bothering me a little bit.
Two F sharps and then an E.
we started out today. Patrick finished Prison on guitar. We just started Hydra. Josh finished his parts on Hydra. Now I'm up to bat.
Sounds good. What are you preferring now?
We have three different heads at our disposal.
This is Fender Supersonic, made to resemble classic Bassman with new features. And it's what we've used live for a long time. And we used it, I think this is the first record we actually used it on the album though. So this was my go-to head for my sound personally.
Down here, these were Garrett's heads. For his clean, he used a classic Fender Bassman. Then you have the vintage Marshall Plexi for all Garrett's gain and stuff. Very awesome, very powerful head. We did not use this cab on anything. I just want
to
make sure.
No, we use it to put stuff on.
Yeah, we used it as a table.
This is Marshall cab. Actually, the same one I have, I think.
This is the Big Muff, supposed to be, I guess, a famous fuzz pedal, but wasn't much fuzzy about it. It was basically just an overdrive or a distortion pedal. We used it on a couple songs, though.
What is a
Showbread record without the fuzz factory? So I think by the end of everything, this is our Tube Screamer, and this is theirs. One, because it says Radio Star, but two, because the back is clean. Ours is full of crap, dried fake blood and dirt and garbage from the garage, hair and stuff. That says, nothing says Showbread like a bunch of trash.
I played a part in the solo, not incorrect as in bad notes, just not the way I wanted to play it. So I'm going to have to ask Rich if I can go back and fix that. It's just a 3-note difference. Watch my play it, he'll be like,
that actually needs to bend a full step up.
Okay. Yeah,
torture all the way up that to it gets to that.
Okay.
Then we had to bring the keyboards out, and we had this interesting setup where we had our MacBooks open with software instruments, and then our Korg MS-2000 open with its synthesis analog modeling system. The keyboard controllers wired into both instruments, and we're playing both things, both me, Garrett, and Patrick, all playing keyboards.
Thank you.
mean, it sounds good, but it seems like it kind of, well, turns it off. Well, to have it be that way throughout, it sounds like it might be better if it's one way and then you hear it a different way in the second verse, you'd be like, oh, different.
Right, nice. Right, because there is nothing else playing in that spot too, and this is, the old way would have left more room for the guitar, I think.
Yeah.
Because now we're stepping in that frequency.
Okay.
Cool.
See what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do.
You
do. I'll go with that. And then in the mix, I'll kind of taste the other part.
Church called The Way, and instead of snake handling, our thing is just walk of faith on glass. You believe if your faith is strong enough,
you gotta do that walk of faith on this broken plate here. Walk of faith, walk of faith, walk of faith. Walk of faith, walk of faith. Walk of faith, walk of faith.
You gotta have faith.
Walk of faith, walk of faith.
Remember that scene in Home Alone when he stepped on the ornaments?
Yeah, it's a
terrible walk of faith.
Now, we have to miss his end because of this.
Walk of faith.
You get through
out. Who wants to be in my church?
I don't.
I'll see you sometime.
That's a little too fanatical for me.
Walk of faith. Come on, man, I'll be in my church.
I think your faith is scattering out across the kitchen, man.
Amen.
Amen.
We went to Winco and got some groceries. We went to the mall.
Hey, Pete, this is the sense of the whole trip. Twinkies.
Hey, Superman eats them, so you know they're good.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Our new friends Luke and Chandra are here.
Oh.
Chandra, I'm sorry. and we're playing Kapunk.
Oh, too.
Luke is trying to bounce the ball into the cup.
Hey, I'm going closer than Drew.
Doesn't take me.
He's getting lucky.
Oh.
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 Nah.
I got Mosey on the screen here.
Okay.
There he is.
Oh, Nathan too, huh?
Yep, Mosey and his best friend.
Okay. It's Burrs. And Nathan. So we got some guitars in.
they are part of the Kickstarter project that we did. Three lucky people chose to donate a certain amount of money, and in return, lucky and generous people, may I add, in return, they will get one of these three guitars that we have and that we will use to make noise on the new album.
That was all done. We started doing the vocals, which is when Sylvia comes into the picture and really produces the singing parts of things, and is a real joy for me each time I've got to work with Sylvia on the vocals, because I am not by any means a talented vocalist, even at my very best. The best I can do is just hope to get by. But Sylvia knows how to give instructions that make sense to help me do the best that I can do.
Let's do it again. This time I want you to use your hands. Really express with your hands.
Okay.
All right? Convince me. Here we go.
So there was no screaming. There was no yelling or anything. It was all just crooning.
Punch!
When the contents of a membrane shell dry and turn to sand, the shell becomes a withered tomb and cracks as it.
Well, you didn't like that.
No, I was thinking more like punches, like, or like maybe like a Frank Sinatra kind of thing, like, yeah.
Oh, okay.
You know, more like, oh, you know, maybe more karaoke style.
Suit yourself.
All right. But that was nice.
And no one seems to wonder why we become so despised. All the evil things we know for seem so righteous in our eyes.
Singing background vocals on this record were both me and Patrick, which we had never, neither of us have ever done on a Showbread album.
Reptiles.
There you go.
I do too, Rich.
I like them.
I think that came out great. We all like the song, Age of Reptiles. That thing is an opus. Yeah, I mean, it's a journey from top to bottom, and the acoustic guitar, piano, or what is it? It's just acoustic guitar, vocal, and then the strings coming in the end. Sick, man. Yeah. Sylvia did such a good job of arranging those string parts at the end.
She really did.
I was blown away.
That one, that whole ending piece just sort of all started falling together right at the end.
Yeah.
You know, that cool cell phone stuff.
All right, man. So good. So good. I'm really proud of that. Did you get feedback in there?
I did for a second. I'm turning myself down.
Try one more time.
Okay.
What is true?
I'm extremely confounded.
Did that elk change?
I was like, you stupid.
Yes, it should be going like.
Oh,
like
you
want
some crazy lead.
I don't know. And that was my only comment about the whole shebang, because I love it.
So
but that was the only spot.
I have a noisy guitar doing some crazy feedback leading up into that part, and then that becomes neener, neener, neener,
that
neener.
Could be it. It could just be... Or just...
Because I don't think I want to have that noise continuing once the neener, neener thing starts.
I hear you.
But
I think that on the spiritual side of the album... it's telling a lot of stories that are real, and sometimes they're kind of jarring. They're so real.
It's true.
The situations that we're talking about and the themes and all are so important to us, because this is how we see them through Jesus.
So I really hope that there are songs on this record that really speak to people, not only from a lyrical context, but also just the music itself, because, you know, I believe the Lord can use whatever He wants to reveal Himself to people.
What I hope spiritually is that this album will touch people in their minds and their hearts, that it'll get them thinking. I think on other Showbread records, we obviously deal a lot with our spirituality, but this record's a little more dense when it comes to the philosophical side, or the existential side of theology and what it means to believe in Jesus and to follow Jesus. And I think that it hits a chord, a beautiful chord, if you will, that resonates with believers and non-believers. A lot of people here in the studio that don't even share the same faith as us are like, the record is beautiful. It's there's something there that's special. And my hope is that the average listener can hear that as well.
It really talks about kind of uncovering things that many Christians are taught throughout their life, which they're taught with good intentions, but when you really look at it and you know, study what the Bible is actually saying, you come to find that a lot of things that you might have heard, you know, from your parents or grandparents or Sunday school or this and that, sounded good at the time. But when you think about it, it's not really what Jesus is calling us to do. We kind of put to shame the idea that as Christians, we think that we are better than another group of people because, you know, say God is on our side or not. And the record really talks about, no matter who you are out there, you know, if you're a Christian that's been raised in the church, if you're, you know, a prostitute out on the streets, if you're a homosexual, if you're a terrorist, if you're a Muslim, if you're this or that, you know, the God that we love and serve, he loves each and every person the same, no matter, you know, where they come from or what they do or even what they believe in. He loves them for just being his creation, and he longs for them to have a relationship with him.
That is so great. I don't think you've ever done a song that's gone like that, has like been so epic before, have you? It's awesome because it seems like this album is a story.
It does, huh?
This kind of has a conclusion.
Right.
But, you know, there's a question at the beginning of the album, and this is somewhat of an answer.
Right.
It's like, it's beautiful.
Jesus, one, us from two, three, duel. Slade. Its roots are twisting up into our hearts. That's every band.
Mm-hmm.